Welcome to this retalk session for .NET Developers Community. My name is Dawa, and if you would like to follow through this demo session for Blazor, please feel free to connect to the Wi-Fi because you will definitely need it. Okay. Maybe I'll just start off with So the topic that I'm going to talk about today is about getting started with Blazor. So there's like, what's Blazor? I will go to it later. So the intended audience for this session is a person who have no prior experience in development or very little experience on .NET core knowledge. So or if you would like to touch on a single page application but do not wish to click on JavaScript, yeah, this is definitely for you. Or for a person who is new to ASP.NET Core and would like to try out some other varieties of a single page application. Okay. So objective. So what do we aim to achieve today is that we are trying to make use of an existing framework, Razor, which is a UI framework that is being used for our MVC platform to implement single page application. Second would be to reduce the learning curve to implement single page application, because it seems like when you learn single page application, you definitely need to know JavaScript, not Java, JavaScript. Okay, so number the note objective is to try out a new ASP.NET Core template. So before that, let me introduce myself. My name is Dawa. I'm a Microsoft certified professional, and I've worked for companies of different sizes and domains. And currently, I'm working in the health and public service sector, but I can't tell you which one. And if you'd like to connect with me, that's my LinkedIn profile. So before I start, anyone who is a hardcore JavaScript fan, any ASP.NET developers here? Okay, great. Who have touched on MVC? Okay, cool. Wow, this is definitely something nice. Okay, anyone heard of Blazor? Okay, these are all experts. So just to set a expectation right, Blazor, this is just an introductory to Blazor. So if you may learn something new here and so, yeah. Okay. So let's talk a bit about single page application. So it stands for single page application, and it's a web apps that load a single HTML page, and then you can interact or communicate with the web app to load a new page and to interact with it. Yep. And the simplest form of single page application is using an AJAX call. So you just call an AJAX and then you just update your screen via the HTML element. Okay. Next one will be. So what makes SPA works easy, like JavaScript frameworks? So as a single page application getting more and more complex, JavaScript frameworks are introduced to help out with this kind of requirements and to make development easier for you to manage. So well-known JavaScript frameworks are Angular, React, Vue, and Ember. And so to touch on Blazor. Blazor is an experimental single page application built on .NET that run on in the browser via WebAssembly. So it used the latest web standards and it run with .NET runtime. So if you're thinking, is it running on .NET Core? No. A .NET framework? No. It's running on Mono. So yeah. So yeah, it consists of lots of modern web framework features. So you can see that there are actually a component model, a routing, layouts, forms and validation, and the list is quite long. So, yep. So let's get started. I will start with a very simple demo with Blazor. And before I start, let me explain to you about the requirements that you need for your machine in order to start. So you definitely need a Visual Studio 2017 or Visual Studio Code, looks fine. And why do they need a preview version? It's because the workload for the Blazor is added later on in the newer version of Visual Studio. And if you are using Visual Studio 2017, then you definitely need to add in the Blazor Language Service Extension, and you definitely need a .NET Core SDK for this one. Okay. So just give you a very simple view. Yep. So in order to create your first Blazor project, you definitely need to install the template first. So for this one, I've already installed the Blazor template. At the same time, I would like to show you the equivalent of this demo, which is the Angular. This is loading. see that this is one of the page that you are going to see on a new Blazor project, and you can see that there's a that's open network, and you can see that when I go to the counter page, there's no loading of a new page from here. And okay, you can see that if I were to click me, it's directly click on the screen. There's no backend call, and then when you go to the fetch data, there's a call to the backend, which is the weather JSON, to retrieve the data, and it's displayed right on the screen. This is a single page application that you can see from here. And okay, let's move on. I will start off with another page. So what is different here is that there's no JavaScript that you need to know from here, and there's no JavaScript at all. And let's see, if I were to do a hard reload, you can see that what is being loaded from the back is actually DLLs. So not to be alarmed about this, where it's actually loading DLL from the back end, and it is safe because it is actually loaded from a mono framework. So what's on the screen here is that there's a navigation menu on the left side, and then there's a main layout as well, which is the main screen. And at the same time, you can see that there are three other pages here, which is the same as the index page. You can see that it's a hello world, and then counter page will be maybe I just put this side by side. Page. This is actually a incremental counter here. So you can see that there is no JavaScript involved here. Okay. And for the fetch data, it's the same for this one. Okay. One of the things that you can see from here is that there's a binding that is being applied on this screen, where you can see all the data that is loaded here is shown via this alliance binding to this place. Okay. So I will talk to you about the components that you can actually add on. So let's see. If I would like to show the counter just now that you see from here, counter on the main page. Let's see. So if I like to add this inside here, how easy would it be for me to move it? So you can see that I can just add a counter like this. So which is the name for this page. So I just add in this one, and I just restart my app, and it will work. See that there's a counter right here. So it's the same thing that where you just can just plug and play your components from other pages to any of the pages. So yep, this is the first part of it. And so let's make some changes to this. So for this page, right, we are adding one for this. How about I would like to change it to, for other pages, I would like to add 10 or 20 for this one. And I can do it by just changing this portion of the code. You can see that there's a function here. And I will just introduce a new parameter. Okay. this parameter, increase it by 1000. Let's do a restart for this. Yep. So the original counter will just increase by 1 or 2. See? But if you go to the main page, and because I actually set it to 1000, it will actually increase by 1000. See? So the power of Blazor. Okay. Next one will be adding a checklist. So today we are going to learn something about Blazor here, and that's definitely a learning checklist for you. Okay. Maybe just start with adding a new navigation. So this is the main navigation panel, and I'd like to add in a new one. And navigation link. Let's call it a checklist. This is the routing method where you can actually create a new routing link via this. So right now it's not working yet because I've not linked it up to any of the back end CHTML. So let's add it in. Okay. I just copied it over from a template that I have. So this is a checklist page that you have, and currently there's nothing being wired up at the back here. You can see that it's actually assigned to a title, but I have not made any changes to it. So right now, if I were to add something, so it doesn't work. And if I were to link it up with the code at the back, and I just need to change this to something else. Let's make some changes to it. Let's create something new. Add a checklist button. And let's find this to a new method that I'm going to add in later on. And the button. And I'll bind this to something else. Checklist. And here, I will introduce a new parameter. Let me check this. And I will create a new method as well. Check this. Okay. So, the string of please don't bother to do anything. If it's not, then I will actually add in the items. Item with the title name. What happens here is that after I add it into my checklist, I will clear the checklist button. Oops, sorry. Okay. So done here and let's run it again.
Is it 917? Then L should be swan. Still capital. Well, 911 the combined should be
sorry. Yeah, this is it. Okay. Thank you. Okay. So right now I will just refresh this screen and I'll just add something. So let's say today we have learned some parameter, and let's say I've learned the components as well, components, and I learned from it. Okay, so this whole thing here is actually being added without any changes without calling to the backend to add it in, and it's displayed right on the screen. So let's make it even better by adding another checkbox. Okay. Yes. Yep, back to here. And I will make it easier for you. I just make the changes right here and I apply it. make some changes to it, right? You actually apply it right away. Can see? Here. Okay. Yep. That's for my demo. Thank you. So where do we go next after this? So you can actually contribute to the development by actually visiting the page here, and maybe you can try out other features that are not covered in this demo by going to the laser.net page, and you can maybe try and think of migrating your JavaScript-based single page application to Laser. So the reference that I've used in this demo is these two sources, which is the GitHub page and the Laser.net. I think that's all. Thank you very much.
Laser talk last month, and I will be able to different one. That's good. Not going to talk about Laser. I'm going to talk about doing number of very good.
Yep.
Thank you. We can compare PowerPoints.
Thank you.
Cheers.
What do you want me to talk about? The weather or Laser?
No, you had some already. I've got a nice one about behavior-driven development within Xamarin or Microsoft or whatever. Or I can do one about what game development with Monogame. Or I could do one about API management. Or one about anything else you've got in mind. Any votes? Nobody cares? Excellent. I'm going to talk about all of them mixed up. Just like three slides of one, then just ten to the middle of something else. That's going to be incomprehensible. I've got a good talk coming. It was the last minute stuff, so I didn't prepare any new talk. But I've got a new talk coming up next week about all the new stuff coming to Xamarin that have been announced and built. A lot of really, really, really good stuff, by the way, that is going to make the development with Xamarin even better than it was already. Right. So let's see what I can do with it. Very, very, very big. BDD, you like it or not, honestly, really? Anybody of you do any test-driven development? 2%. How about behavior-driven development? No? Do you know what that is? It is not a brand of Schwing of Amazon. That is good. Okay, well, let's do this one because why not? All right, Bim. Hello, my name is Ben. I like cucumbers and mobile phones. I'm a Xamarin and Microsoft MVP. And what else do I do? I've got a company in Singapore called Xamariners. And we do development for people that want to give us lots of money, which is good. If you want to give me a lot of money, I will accept it happily. Can I take some money? Yeah, just that. For speakers, you know, we need to eat as well. So I like to eat cucumbers, which are very, very nice. Right, the good thing is that because it's a lot of new stuff, I haven't been practicing this org at all, so it's going to be extremely clunky, but it doesn't matter. If you get really bored, we can do something else, but that is actually a good thing. I did this talk like in Toronto like a couple of months back, and people didn't even realize it was possible to do BDD with Xamarin, and it is. I mean, just like as a unit test, you can obviously do that as a UI functional test, but blah. So a programmer is going out for a stroll in the evening, and his wife asks him to swing by the store and pick a gallon of milk and if they had eggs to get a dozen. They return with 12 gallons of milk and say they had eggs. Actually, there is a more like as per today attending of this joke. So the outgoing prime minister of Malaysia, his wife asked him if he could just call an electrician, and he actually called an election
and as a result, he's got no more power. That's very fair. Right, moving on. What is BDD? So that stands for behavior-driven development, which is, that is kind of a bit clunky, but an outside-in, pool-based, multiple-stakeholder, multiple-scale, high-automation, agile methodology. I'm going to explain roughly what that means, because gibberish. So outside-in, it means that you are going to look at doing your development from the end bit, which is usually the user interface, from the user point of view, and then you are going to go from that point of view and get inside your application and develop until its core. As opposed to development that could be done the other way by developer, which is, like, don't give a shit about the user, do whatever we want because it's fun, and then the user is going to have like some kind of half-baked banana that won't know how to do with that. Don't let developers do specification, it ends badly, because that is the inside out. We need to do the outside in. Which is just, hey, let's make sure that we're going to do the product the way we want. What is important about multiple stakeholder? That means that this is it's pretty much an universal language that is not only for developers, but specifically for QA, engineers, BAs, UX architect, any PM, or any stakeholder of the application. It's just a unified language that everybody can understand, unlike, let's say, Objective-C. Nobody can understand, I believe, except if I'm wrong. I really don't like Objective-C, usually I'm about to say that at every single presentation. I don't like Objective-C! No, I'm better. High automation, yes, it's just very, very well suited just to make everything run perfectly smoothly. So the engineer that you hire, and that costs a lot of money, by the way, are focusing on what actually matters, which is doing some good code and make them happy, and not about just like let's say peeling potatoes, the same potato over and over again, which is kind of boring after a while. Although it's, you need to peel potatoes sometimes. Or you can buy some baby potatoes that got like a skin that is not so rough, and then you don't need to peel the skin. That's got nothing to do with anything, but that's the way I talk. And agile methodology, I'm not going to go through that because otherwise it will be there tomorrow. But yeah, lean is good. So it describes a cycle of interaction with well-defined outputs. Resulting in the delivery of working tested software that matters. That's very, very, very correct. That's what we want to do. So basically, it's a bunch of tiny stories using a particular grammatical structure that is called Gherkin, I believe, and then you just have like different kind of variation depending on how it's going to run. But the grammar is just literally five keywords that we're going to go through. It's finding places of misunderstanding and filling it with understanding. Again, just different words can mean different things to different individuals. It could be as easy as not having a common jargon on the domain that you are going to develop application on, or it's simply people think differently, and an Apple can be somebody else. Mobile phone is Apple. Okay, that's an Apple mobile phone. That's not a very valid. And ultimately, that is a conversation that you try to capture, is when you are talking about what you want to achieve, let's try to be very precise and very simple so you don't have like a ton of paperwork that nobody will read later on. Let's just go straight to the core. So as I mentioned, it's just like not solely beneficial to developers, it's just a bit for everyone, right? So developer, testers, project owners, project managers, scrum masters, and whoever are playing a part into the happy journey that is developing software. So, are you familiar with user stories? Anybody in the room uses user stories? 2, 3, 3, 3.5, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4. You win, sir. You win.
What?
No, actually, there's nothing, but nothing to. Hold on. I might have something to win. I got something to win. Oh, no, really? Okay, I could have had something to win, but that. It's not over yet. I think I've got one sticker from a random conference that I went to that could be a winnable one. Maybe in a very bad shape because I could have just like carried it for a long, long time. Maybe there's something to it. If I found something, I'll give it to you. So a vertical user stories are just pretty much like a way to see a cake as when we're looking at delivering a ATM system. So when the guy that just started to develop the first ATM system, they just had multiple choices to develop this thing. Either just like decide to make
working slices of the cake that can only be eaten whenever they are fully ready, which is, okay, we need to have the database sorted, we need to have the old user interface, the network, this or that, and just a bit of absolutely everything before we can actually see the product working. And a lot of it is just like bloaty, something that you didn't really need. We need to have all the service implemented, and we're getting in a kind of waterfall model with everything should be there before being able to actually be picking at a working model. So the problem of doing that is just the most time you spend while not showing what you're going to deliver, well, the chances of your software development going wrong are pretty big if you start doing something that the actual product owner doesn't want. So let's say that you're doing this ATM system and you start by doing a feature which is show of not show my balance. What is useless in ATM? Print my balance, pretty good too. Win a cinema ticket. Here we go. You probably can just do that in ATM those days. So if the developer will start just implementing this feature that nobody really cares about, although cinema is pretty good, but that's probably not the first thing you want to do when you use an ATM. Well, you spend like 6 months on that. Say, here we go, ta-da, we've got a great Windows Cinema ticket on your ATM machine. Can I withdraw some money? Ah, no, but wait for it, it's going to come one day. So that's not what you want to do first, right? So basically that is not very, very cool. Horizontal, so it's very difficult to prioritize as well, because when they did the initial rollout for the ATM, basically the customers wanted the ability to withdraw their money 24/7, and to check their balance. So based on the marketing research, withdrawing the cash will account for 90% of the intended usage of the ATM. So logically, nowadays, if you want to be first to market, you're just going to really focus on that thing. Just like, okay, let's get that done, MVP, and MVP like the Microsoft One, like most valuable product, and then let's see about winning cinema tickets. Right? So it could have been easily achieved with two stories that would be, as a user of ATM, I want to withdraw cash from my bank account. Excellent. Or as a user of ATM, I want to get the current balance of my bank account. Very good. So that's just like two stories. If you build that, then you know you can have a product that actually works. ATMs are not very complicated. There's just a bunch of security that goes around them, but otherwise, just basically simple ledger operation. So if the development team originally would have focused on this thing instead of faffing about just trying to do everything at once, well, they probably could have gone out to market a bit earlier and therefore win more shares of whatever they were winning share of, and the world would have had ATMs a bit earlier. So now, rather vertical user story. So instead of building the system layer by layer, the security, the storage, the whatever, all the bits that you actually need to get your product working, well, you're just going to do little bits, just like that actually constitutes a feature. Instead of saying, let's just build the system from the inside out, which is just, I want a database, and I want to focus on the security and on the login, the credential, la la la. No, it's like, I just want the user to be able to log in, right? So let's look into that. So just like, a vertical resource story is not a scenario, so it is just constituted of quite a lot of scenarios, positive scenarios and negative scenarios. So for instance, let's say that you want to withdraw money from your bank account. You've got $100 on your bank account and you try to withdraw $1,000. Well, you just want to make sure that it fails, because otherwise the bank is going to be in trouble. And you want to do all the positive scenarios, such as, all right, I've got $100, I'm going to try to withdraw like $50 and maybe $20, or just like make some successions and just add some money and then just withdraw a little bit. So you just want to make sure that all the cases are catered about. Your validation, for instance. So positive scenarios, for instance. User enters the wrong password. User enters the amount larger than the daily withdrawal limit, and so on. Negative scenarios, wrong bank, expired bank card, customer forgot the password, and so on. So the vertical stories should be written in a way that is just like very, very clear and unambiguous. So everybody will be able to understand the story the same way. So there is no quiproquo, and therefore everybody is on the same boat. We build the same thing. So that is probably a diagram you may have seen before, or if not, that's what it is. You've got two kind of axes in building quality software. You've got one which is this axis, which is building the right product, and then this is a product built right. So building the right product is just you have some specification, and you want to actually make sure that what you build are the specification. So if you are trying to build a car, you don't want to deliver a rubber ducky, because otherwise that's going to be a bit of a problem with the specification, right? And you want the product to be built in a way that is going to be make sure that the product actually works at the first place and will be easy to maintain, and that will be having a long, nice life and not crawling under technical debt. Basically, if you have a product that is not the right stuff, so you built a completely wrong stuff and it's not even well built, well, that's not going to be working very well. That's what we call, in our technical term, useless crap, right? If you have a product that is actually well built, wow, it's just like super maintainable, the code is beautiful, it's great. But if it is, again, just not the right specification, so if you just build what wasn't asked for, well, your business is not going to be very happy. Basically, if you also have a good product but it's badly built, the maintenance is going to suffer and your company will shut down. What you want is have your product to be built right and the right product. That is good. And there are some ways to achieve that. Absolutely. So let's talk about the different kind of tests that are available when you build a product. So you've got, first of all, the maintainability bit, which is unit testing. Everybody's been doing probably some unit testing on some sort, which is making sure that the individual building block of your software, such as like at the very simple, just let's say that is a function that is adding two numbers, you can test that and just make sure that if I just give this function one and one, well, I want to have two back. If I've got one back, well, then my addition is not working really well. You've got integration tests, which is just having tests that will validate that two subsystems, for instance, are going to be working together. So the one we're talking about today are acceptance tests, which is we have a specification, and what we would like to get is that, what we wanted is actually what it is, which is if I just have a login page with a username and password text box and a login button, when you put your right username and password, click on login, well, that's going to be all good. You're going to be redirected to whatever page, which is your authenticated page, and that is right. If that is not working, well, then that's not very good. Then you've got the manual testing, which is, even on our days of automation, still quite absolutely needed, really, because this is where like the nasty bugs are going to lurk. Because well, you can automate your test as much as you want, ultimately, if you don't do the same operation 27 times while navigating to another page in between, which is going to screw up the whole state, well, you never know that happens. So it is very good to have, only humans so far are pretty good at doing that, just using the application on the way it shouldn't. Which is the case, the problem with users, or even us developers as users, we are using whatever tools that are being built for us to use in the completely wrong way. Just I've been recently speaking to the Xamarin team, and they just told us that we're crazy just to do what we're doing, because it's not made to do what you're doing, but we're doing it anyways, and we're breaking the product. Fantastic. So then we are pretty much navigating from test-driven development, which is literally doing this kind of unit test when you are simply trying to validate like a chunk of your logic, just like that, with no specific. It's very it's not really machine or human readable. Just I'm going just to simply have a test which is addition, and you're going to put one as a parameter, one and another parameter, and expect two, and you're going to do that quite a lot. Test-driven development, I found out, was something slightly clunky because nobody really knows what to do with it. It's just, why should I test and rewrite the logic that I've got on my business logic library? That is pointless, just like repetition. Well, if you do that this way, that is going to be repetition indeed. But basically, it just requires the user, which is basically the developer, to actually think about what they're supposed to be testing. What I like about behavior-driven development is just pretty straightforward. You don't have to think about it. just literally get your statement, your definition, and then you literally that generates your test scenario steps, and that we're going to talk about a little bit later, automatically, and you just need to comply to those steps and build the software the way it should be built. Yeah, so they're different from unit tests because unit tests are for developer and help you build the thing right, which was one of the axes. The BDD really wants to do both things, ensure that you are going to build the right thing and you are going to build it right, because it's going to remove quite a lot of crap that we can get in modern software development. Giving you an example, for instance, let's think about it for a second, over-engineering, which is when developer thinks it's a very, 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 very good idea to think in the future and say, you know what, my method that should have been very simple, I'm going to try to make it future-proof and add a lot of other features that nobody really asked for, and that is going to clutter the code, make potentially some stuff break, and ultimately is going to cause something that we call technical debt, that will end up being deleted by someone. Personally, my favorite stuff when writing code is deleting code. I love deleting code. Just like doing that all the time. So good. You should try just like write some like a really crappy code and then delete it, or just like do a lot of pull requests. You'll find something that are just like worth deletion. So yes, behavior-driven development expands on test-driven development by formalizing its best practices. So basically, looking at all the sunny side of test-driven development, but putting it in a format that is digestible and that is going to provide some results. It's a specifically the outside-in view, which is we are looking at the user interface, not at the business logic that is inside. We're just going to validate what is happening, what we're seeing. We are writing the test in such a way that anybody can read it. As long as you can read, you can understand the test. ultimately, it's just like share a common language and come up with like some unified jargon that will allow an easy communication between the folks. So it's just like illustrating what is jargon. It's just like, for instance, if you are on your domain, you're calling like a user and a consumer, for instance, that could be just like a case where your jargon will not be just well defined, and you end up having a code where both keywords are being used and you don't know what is what, or it could be something completely different. It's kind of nice just to make sure that what one technical reference that will just ensure that your model is only called with specific terms. So what does it look like? Well, that's a typical cucumber acceptance test, such as feature. Sign up should be quickly and friendly. So a feature that is pretty much, a feature really, that is a collection of scenarios that will validate a specific use case, that's all. The scenarios are just going to make sure that this use case is totally tested, which means that all the ways we can use this use case are going to be around it. So we make sure that all the validation in place is actually there. So a new user should get a confirmation email and be greeted personally. And then you have the actual step definition, such as, given I have chosen to sign up, when I sign up with valid details, then I should receive a confirmation email and I should see a personalized good usage. That's about it. That, the given, when, then, and end are pretty much a building block of cucumber. That's literally what it is. But you're just like speaking in English. Thing to know about that is just pasting this test into a IDE tool such as SpecFlow will actually generate some code, which is demonstrated a little bit later. So cucumber is just like a command line tool that will process those text files ultimately, and behind the scene that is going to create some classes and some methods that are going to be bound through regular expression with the actual definition of the text file that your test contains. So all the bits that we have here that is going to create, for instance, a class called signup,
and is going to have so one scenario, which is just like a collection of those tests, really called a successful signup. And all of those, given when that end, are going to actually be represented as methods that are bound to these text lines by the actual regular expression, which is pretty much this this line of text. Yeah, well, I went through that already. So the good stuff about Cucumber as well is kind of test runner agnostic, that is going to generate some code that ultimately will be turned into NUnit, XUnit, or any other test framework that you use, and that can be run itself by, let's say, a NUnit runner, or like a MS Microsoft test runner, or can be run also by in the Xamarin kind of environment, using something called Test Cloud, that's now part of something called App Center, which allows to run some tests on physical devices that are hosted in the farm of physical devices, which ultimately will just be able to run interaction, real interaction on real phones, such as I enter my username and my password, tap on the button, and something happens. So that is kind of cool.
Let's have a look what we are doing this time.
Might accelerate that to actually give a demo. So you've got your requirements, which are test files. So you've got features, which is pretty much a high-level feature. Scenarios, which are all the bits that you want actually to validate or to execute. And the steps, which are all the lines that are contained within the scenario. And that is going to be changed into step definition codes, which are just methods that are bound through a regular expression attribute to the line that are actually the steps. That is going to talk to whatever framework you're using. For instance, in the .NET world, we're using mostly Speckflow, I suppose, and then I'm going to talk directly to the system that is hosting the application you need to test. I'm going to skip that. Bjarkin is just like pretty much an implementation of Cucumber, that's literally what it is, just again, another example. Scenario credit card number too short, that's the scenario definition. When I enter a credit card number that is less than 16 digits long, and all the other details are correct, and I submit the form, then the form should be redisplayed, and I should see a message advising me of the correct number of digits. So that is the Gherkin format syntax. So that is a feature. The feature keyword is used to group a set of tests. So if you want to come up with a feature, you have to think as a user. So usually you will get a BA if you've got one of those, or you'll do a little bit of user survey. That will be very good as well. But you need to have somebody that is not necessarily a developer that will be able just to maintain those stuff. So you just have to think, in order to meet some goal as a type of user, I want a feature, such as in order just to log in into this application as a unauthenticated user, I want to log in successfully, possible, in order to be able to continue my journey for this application. So for each type of user, you want to be able to write potentially different scenarios or use a feature called example that allows you to reuse the same scenarios with different set of data. It's just like plugging a database table and just fill replace the syntaxes that you can define in your stem. You've got to figure out what goals you're trying to achieve, what tasks will be performed, and how does our system support those tasks. For instance, to give you an example, for any application, which is mobile application that is enterprise size, that would have maybe, let's say, 30 different screens, probably end up with having, I don't know, 200 scenarios, maybe. We'll see how they look like, so the keywords are given, establish context. So given is going to say, given I am unauthenticated, given I am on the home page, given whatever. That is just like providing the context you're currently in. When I click a button, when I navigate to whatever page, when I log out, or when I tick this tick box, this is when you perform an action. And then this is your outcome. Then I see a pop-up with a bad password, or then I am navigated to the homepage or whatever. This is just the action that, the outcome that that follows the action. So given money, withdraw money from account. Given I have $100 in my account, when I request 20, then $20 should be dispensed, and I will have $80 remaining in my account. You can also use AND. AND is just a repeat of the previous keyword. So for instance, when I request $50, then my card should not be returned, and I should be told to contact the bank. Behind the scene, an AND here, because it follows a then, is actually a then. If we have a when, an AND following a when, that is also going to be a when statement. Although that is unlikely that you will have multiple ones, but. Yes, something to bear in mind is your scenario should be stateless. That means that you don't want to keep somewhere, expect that the outcome of a scenario can be reused on another scenario. Because first of all, you can run your tests simultaneously, and all the tests you want to run are supposed to be really self-contained. Otherwise, that's not absolutely right. Although when you're using a runner such as Test Cloud, so testing on mobile phone farms, testing like a user interface by clicking buttons through a computerized mechanism, you could tell the system to actually not kill and reinstall the application. You can say, okay, I run this test, please stay where you are, and then we can run the next one. But that is specific to this kind of test. So yes, technology stack, really, each language is stack has their own flavor. In the .NET world, there's going to be spec flow really running with XUnit and unit MS test and so on. All those runners will be able to work with literally any CI or CD system that's integrated with most IDEs and is open source. So BDD provides the only test you need for your application to achieve. Well designed apps, well implemented, over engineering free, high level test coverage, highly maintainable code base. it's just like a quick note on like mobile fragmentation. You are well aware that Android runs pretty much on anything, on any form factors, on any varieties of operating system iterations. iOS is slightly less disorganized, I suppose, but you still have quite a fair amount of mix and match happening there. So I found out, for instance, that a lot of features that could work nicely on most mobile phones will quite often fail on Samsung device. I don't know why, calling bloatware or whatever, but that is just a fact. The problem is just I don't have a million Samsung mobile phone or a million iPhone devices or whatever. So it's kind of nice to be able to have this access to this kind of mobile phone farms or tablet farms that will have a variety of form factors, brands, and operating system. So you can actually run your test visually on those devices, and it will just take pictures as you go and tell you the memory usage, and when it fails, it will just give you a nice look to easily figure out what is happening. that's pretty much what a UI test is. A UI test, the problem, but the pros of a UI test when you run the test on the actual device, that is closer to the truth, but that is going to be expensive, both in time and in money, because running a test on the physical, real device, physical device, that's going to be slightly faster than a human. That's it would take a bit of time. And unfortunately, our company likes to make money a bit, and I will just charge you for using processing power. You could do that, create your own mobile phone farm that is going to cost you a fortune. So maybe you don't want to do that. Then you've got the acceptance console test, which is what I like a lot, which is literally on the, well, I do quite a lot, a fair bit of Xamarin in development, right? So we're using the MEVM pattern, you may or may not be familiar with, but basically it's just the next level below the user interface, which is completely disconnected from the UI itself, but anything that is happening on the UI, any action or any piece of data, will be driven by the view model, so basically with this MEVM pattern. So you can safely more or less assume, more than less, that you can test directly this view model, because that is going to be a really good representation of what is happening. But it's going to happen very, very fast. So I can run, let's say, like 200 very long or relatively long scenarios within a couple of seconds. If I had to run the same scenarios on a mobile device, that's probably going to take, I don't know, a few hours to a day. So that's kind of nicer to do that this way. So it runs really fast, but it's not the UI layer, it's just like the next best thing. You can technically, there's something coming our way with Xamarin that will allow us to actually test the user interface, but that's another talk. So the best approach would be probably just to write maybe once your BDD tests, run them continuously for the cheap version every time somebody commits into, let's say, the your development branch. At least run all your suite of tests if you can just have a pre-commit test trigger that is going to make sure everything runs before somebody can commit their code into the dev branch, that's even better. And then run your UI test less often, but every time at least you are, yes, going to merge something into, again, the main branch. All right, let's have a quick look at some tests. That is very, very big. Why is my screen so big? That's horrible. What can I do about it? I can try to... Okay, display settings. Yeah. No. That sounds fun. That is not going to be very good. That maybe? Better, slightly better, okay, slightly better, so that will do. Let me get one of those maybe. What happens here? Let's get something else very quickly. Again, I didn't really prepare that thing, and I'm taking far too much thing that I shouldn't be clicking on. Just going to be slightly lazy. Going to give you some example of real test, and I can probably just like run something else because it's getting rapidly late-ish. Preparing a solution. Oh, that's a dark theme. James Montemagno will kill me. What can I do? That didn't really expire, but it just pops up from time to time. Well, the network is not great. Go away. Let's see if you can see more as well. I'm just using big fonts. Anybody's been using Xamarin at all in the room? No? Yes! Okay, cool. Xamarin is getting better. It just got better like 2 days ago. Now you can build your user interface in real time with whatever crazy framework you're using in the background without having to recompile and restart and all that. It's just like nice and live, a bit like Flutter. Probably we'll do a Flutter talk one day because Flutter is also very, very good. But not today. Okay, let's have a look at some tests. Oh, something simple, if possible. Login page. Excellent! That's a login page. So, for instance, here, that is logging with valid credentials. So, given I am an authenticated user, will then navigate to the login page view, and I log in with mobile number, and password, very, very secure password. I'm going to make it a bit bigger, and very secure password, then I am authenticated. So that is a spec flow file definition. So what happens behind the scene is that, so I'm just going to, wow, that was loud. Now, as I mentioned a bit before, we're using like regular expression, which are just like strings here because nothing fancy is happening, to bind to it. So, given I am an unauthenticated user, here, that's pretty much here. Given then I am an unauthenticated user, or if I want to use I am unauthenticated, that's fine. If I just put an S here, just for the sake of breaking things, this one will say, oh no, I don't know what it is anymore. Where is my step definition? Let's put an S. Yes, I'm back in. Excellent. So you've got like full intelligence there, just like about what your test samples that you did as. Let's just put that back. So again, the idea of having those done here is that the first stuff you write before even starting your development, you just want to have your test, like your feature file done. Why doesn't it change back to what I look at? You want to have that done before doing the implementation. We'll just go through an example a bit later. I'm just going to go through something that exists, and then we'll just go implement a very small whatever, and show you that you need to do it first. So given I am an unauthenticated user, so how do you attest that? Well, first of all, here I've got a state in my application. So I am a big fan of dependency injection on mobile, so you've got like some pros and cons, but well, I like it very much. We're testing a mobile application here, by the way, just for a second, that's exam right there. So I just take an instant a hook on my cache service, which is where I can put all my states and all the bits and bobs that I want to persist and then have open, that's where it goes, and I take my state there. And then on my state, I want the is authenticated property to be false. Right? Make sense so far? Excellent. And then when I navigate to the login page, what do I do here? So here I'm saying, hey, I want to hook on my navigation service, and I am going to navigate to the page we mentioned, which behind the scene is going to do absolutely just that. And then I'm just taking like a view model base, just like all the view models in my application are sharing the same one, so that's just like inheriting from it. And I just look at the current view model type, and the name should be equal to the patch name plus view model. That should be very, very simple. And when I log in with a mobile number, and password, so here that's getting more interesting. So now I'm actually getting a hook on my login page view model. So just for the one that are not familiar, I'm going to show you what that kind of means. For the one that are familiar, well, they'll have to have a go at it too. To reduce that to 110 and to 100 maybe, because also otherwise we're going to see nothing much. So let's see where we are. We are here. So here I've got a login page view model, which is under my view models, but I also have a login view model. Login page, which is XAML, which is, if you've been doing some WPF, you know what it is. If you've been doing some Xamarin, you know what it is. If you don't know what it is, well, just do something about it. That is a user interface markup language, a bit like HTML, but for application, extensible application markup language. Microsoft came up with that, just like Microsoft came up with Ajax, like Microsoft came up with a lot of things that we think they didn't, but they did. So that is the definition of my login page. What have we got here? That's just some logo here, entry, path. So this entry is just like a text box, really. And it is bound to something called my mobile number. So that is just a property of the view model, which is basically the bit that is holding the data, right? And here we've got like a password field, for instance, right? And then somewhere, I guess, we'll have a nice little button. want to have a little button somewhere. Where's my button? Ah, here we go. Button here. Where are you? Button. Here we go. Button. And my button is associated or bound to a comment. Just in 2 seconds, a comment is. Are you familiar with comments at all? Yes. No. Yes. One. The guy with the headphones. Are they good headphones at least? Are they?
Yeah. It's no sound. I'm listening.
Yeah, I was generally interested. I've got these Bose like headsets, the ones that have active cancellation. Somebody just committed suicide after just spending too much time with them because he has got completely fucked up by just compressing and decompressing, and he couldn't live with that anymore. Although when you travel and you've got a baby in a plane for 12 hours, having those headsets are really, really good. You can actually sleep. Well, then your baby might be crying and just having a very bad time, but you can sleep, so that's cool, right? I'm actually looking for something that is not necessarily active noise cancellation. Therefore?
Is that
the Bose one as well?
Yeah.
I think it's just, maybe the guy was very depressed or whatever, but just my wife told me that like a couple of days ago, I'm actually wearing those like for a long time because it's really good noise cancellation. But yeah, whatever. I don't really like the one that are just like inbuilt though. Maybe the guy that just had this accident at the like the new version. That's probably the best version. Is it the wireless or the?
I'm not sure whether or not it's wireless.
yeah, wireless. I haven't tried those. Did you try the? Well, whatever. I'm here to try.
If someone wants to try, there is a try in session afterwards.
Yeah, just like the sound quality may be different. Anyways, comments. Are you familiar with event-driven development?
Yes.
Yes? Actually, who is familiar with development altogether here? okay, developers. How many developers in the room? All right, cool, sure. Why do we develop then? So I can just like adapt the 20 minutes I have remaining based on that. Applications, develop properties, develop what? Yeah, you. There you go. What do you do?
you develop application, right? They develop websites, web application, right? So which framework do you use? MVC. MVC, so you should be kind of familiar with that. How about you, sir?
Windows
application. Excellent. Windows is dying. Right? That's cool. You've been there for a while, a bit. It is. Just like at the build, basically. So every time there was a mention in Azure for operating system, it was Linux, then Windows, and then something else. That was Windows was never on top. That was a bit sad, but well, that's the way it is. Cool. Well, so yeah.
Training systems.
Yeah. but anyway. So yes, there were a couple of developers and stuff. So. Comments are good because they're completely disconnected from the user interface. The problem with event-driven development, you still have some kind of tight binding with your good old on-click, la-la-la, event argument, da-da-di-da-da-da, that is going to be pretty difficult to test without the user interface. So comments just probably use this, and also it's got like a ball of all the nice you have, such as can execute. So if you're if your validation or whatever is not happy, you can tell a button not to be enabled without having to do anything. Anyway, so that's the user interface. Nice, great. And here we've got a view model. So that is what in your MVC that will be a kind of ease the controller, but not really, because it doesn't really perform much. It's just going to take the data from some services and whatever, and then just use binding to give that to the user interface. So it does some stuff. What was my point? My point was, yes, we were looking at those things, the steps. So I authentication step, that's it. So when I log in with my mobile number and password, so that is the step definition here that is coming again from that guy there. Username, mobile number, string, whatever, and password, string, whatever. That is going to be transformed into this regex, mobile number, string, whatever, password, string, whatever. And you will have some parameters on your method, mobile number and password, right? That is automatically generated for you, not the actual names of the parameters. but all the rest. Again, I'll generate 1 week later. So then that allows me to do something along the line. Hey, can you just populate the mobile number of my view model with that thing that is coming from the test? Do the same with the password, and then please click on the sign in button. So that is literally how you do as a user, right? So when I click on the sign in command, go to implementation, that is, doesn't matter what it is, it's just on the mobile development world, you just have to make sure that your UI thread is never blocked by the evil other processing. So you're doing a fair amount of asynchronous programming to make sure that it's always responsive. And you think that async await is the response to everything? No, it isn't, unfortunately. You need to use observables, so reactive programming to some extent. Ultimately, it boils down to timer. You need to enter the name of this timer command that is just simply going to check that something is happening from time to time and leave the user interface to be super responsive. So just if you look into reactive programming, ultimately, be it for React Native or for React JS or for actually React on the .NET platform, that's pretty much a lot of nice T's around a timer. And that command is going to be talking to the actual proper command implementation. Where are you, Vim? Okay, well, send command, sign in command. Not sign in, not the command, sign in. Da-da-da. So that is a wrapper that is around a actual command that is going to do something such as signing in by just calling a service, and then it's going to say, all right, we're signed in, that's very good, or it's going to say, oh no, we've got an error, and that is going to be unsuccessful. So the point here is just like the test is coming there first, and the series of tests are going to validate that I've been logging in successfully, and that I navigate to the happy place, which will be, in this case, homepage. So if everything is successful, I will just navigate to my homepage and I will be able to test that. If it is unsuccessful, I'm adding an error to a service that is then just going to be taken care of by the UI and displays some kind of messages. But everything has been written on the way that is testable because my tests were there first and I needed to make sure that I can test that thing, login unsuccessful. This is why I got an error service that is going to be can get a hook on my testing framework. If I had to test like a pop-up with a message written on it, I don't have a user interface. I just need to be able to get that anyways. So that actually forces you to write things in a really loosely coupled way, which is nice because then you just don't have a headache of maintenance and interdependencies and just like clarity is really kicking in. And you can just validate absolutely everything, which is nice and beautiful. And this is how things should be. And then if I'm authenticated, I'm going to, I'm not testing anything, I'm just saying when I log in with whatever, so I log in, and then I'm very happy. And then I'm saying that I am authenticated. So let's have a look. It should simply say, hey, the states that I was testing at the very start to make sure that it was unauthenticated, basically it was authenticated equal false. Now it is true and everybody will be very happy. All right, let's run that. Whenever you're ready, Cortana. It looks a bit like a Cortana thing now, right? Because everything's a Cortana. Time. Really? Yeah, clapping of the hands always work. Try it sometimes. Okay, that, and then let's rather just put it there. Pin. Okay. Let's cure the stuff. Doesn't really matter, but it's just like some configuration here. I'm doing quite a fair bit of dependency injection, so I've got like some configuration that is going just to set different set of services depending whether I am testing or not.
So let's do something like that. I have nothing about that, so I'm going to rebuild that. It's going to get a little bit of time. Not that much. So far, any questions, by the way? Yeah, does it make any sense, or is that just like I'm going speaking too fast? Again, I didn't prepare for this presentation because I didn't be able to act last minute, so it was a bit clunky, but yeah, I'm just wondering if you are appreciating the stuff. Does it make sense? Do you see the benefits of doing that kind of stuff? That works not only with Xamarin, .NET, JavaScript, Ruby, whatever you want to use, that is absolutely cool. Yeah, usually I would have prepared a small demo application, but because I didn't write until I came into this room, it looks like, and I updated my .NET and frameworks and all that until the last time I wrote the very small sample application, where you've got like a very big, not sample application. but that is up to date, so it's going to actually run. Otherwise, there would have been a lot of red everywhere, and it would have gone nowhere. So now, just like the trade-off is we need to wait for this thing to compile, which I could have done at the very start, but I forgot about it because I'm forgetful. There we go. Sometimes. It will get somewhere. It's, I can prove it's doing something. If I go to the output, it's doing absolutely nothing. But it will do something.
Question.
Yes.
Do you share the test specifications with your end users?
Sorry, do I what?
Do you share the test specifications?
Well, ultimately, yes, that would be the best thing to do. It should be done all together.
How do you format it?
Cucumber. Everything is cucumber. That's the thing. It's just like because you everybody understand that, that is precisely what you want, because otherwise you start making, I don't know, like a pizza when the guy wanted a burger. So if you don't give the specification of the pizza with your customer, say, okay, a pizza should have some sesame buns and some beef patties, some salad and some ketchup. And then you go, that's a burger. I wanted a pizza. So it's better to share the thing.
Would it automatically create a Word document for you?
Automatically create a Word. So you think about it, say, all right, I think about an application, everything on the Word document. No. Just have to just use your hands to write what you want to build.
What I mean is that you have the test specifications in your feature file.
So the test specification, actually, to be honest, you can use. So I use Jira, for instance. Jira's got a great plugin called NBehave or something like that, or maybe something else, and you can put that straight into your stories. I can show you how to do that. That's all. And something went red. File is not, that's not true. See, it's lying. Succeeded and say it failed. But let me just do like a little ellipsis to Jira. So tralala, that's I'm going to put a little bit more of that thing there. Here we go. Acceptance criteria, excellent at the scenario. Feature, so for instance, this is like literally I put our stuff there already, but I can create a new feature or whatever. Let's say that it's for the about us page scenario path. Here we go. Or you can just create a new scenario from scratch if you want. You can add a scenario. And a scenario. And nothing is happening. Well, then you can sort that. Add a
personal here. I mean, this is literally what I've been doing. Yes, personal steps. Scenario and eat the pizza. Given the context, given I am hungry, when I see a pizza, then I throw, then I grab it, and I. Click on the first item. Excellent. The item with whatever game scenario. Please select a credit scenario. Why? Excellent credit scenario. Yeah. Now I should have a scenario. Here we go. It will be simple, probably. Very good. Then the scenarios you can attach to your stories, right? As you see, and then the developer will be simulator. Why didn't it appear? Whatever, I just an example of some previous scenario. It's just something that looks like that, right? So you just ask your QA or whoever just to try to put them here, then to review with your customer, so involve your customer into the process, and then your developer is just going to go like that, you know, copy and paste that thing, only that thing. Cool, thank you very much. And then you are going to have a developer that is going to do something along the line of, let me just put something there, add a class, yeah. No, not a class, sorry, that's too long to do at all. That's fine, okay. I want to add a specs flow feature file, which is like meetup test, whatever, that feature. Yeah. Then your developer is going to delete all that, maybe, and actually feature can forget the feature there. Or just scenario. That's the feature meetup test in order to whatever as a hamburger. I want to be told the truth. That's not a really good scenario, a feature, but doesn't matter. Write something random and they did it. So that's great. So now, I mean, that's not a really good thing. Well, you just paste that there. Problem is just those are actually done already, but let's do something new, so now outline, add to multiply if you're crazy. Repeat what I say. So when I given I have ears, that's good, have ears, perfect. When I have a mouth, I have a mouth, better mouth, given I say something, then you hear. Something. It's very good. Best test ever made. Then I'm going to save this file, Control S. There you go. And I'm going to do something like generate step definitions. So I recognize all my steps there, and I want to either do copy to clipboard, but I want to generate it on the file that I'm going to put wherever, like on the desktop. Nothing to do with anything, doesn't matter. Desktop and meetup test. Steps. Fantastic. It should not really be on the desktop, but it should be at the right place. But whatever. Yep, now I've got my steps that are here.
So now we can see that this is the steps that I had before. So given I have enough, so apparently the context is pending. Oh, actually, let me run that. Then we can implement this beautiful test. As no examples define what you mean. True. I think true. Let's go back to the feature, actually. Scenario. It's not a scenario outline, it's just a scenario. Running tests. Running. Go away. Wait up. Oh, I'm loading the project. Excellent. Let's reload it. Run my unit test, please. Scenario outline is if you when you want to specify some examples. Don't trust this thing, it's actually everything is fine. So now I can run my tests. I'm using the test UI from Sharper because it's nice. It's actually going to run everything. You'll see that here I've got like maybe about 50 tests. And you can see they're fairly involved, so tests are just like quite big and it runs in it's finished to run this test for run, right? And the tests are just like big, right? Just going to give you some example of tests again. Proper stuff, and each step has got like some pretty cool. No, that's just no proper test, and each line is going to execute a lot of stuff, so it is substantial. It's not, and it goes very very fast, as we said. Right, it goes. So now let's find this test that we added that is called meetup test feature. Excellent. So, inconclusive. Why is it inconclusive? Because one more step definition are not yet implemented. That is absolutely right. This is precisely what happened. So, let's go back to our meetup test feature. Go away. So, given I have a mouth, go to step definition. So, we need to implement that. So, let's say that Excellent, I've got a mouth. She's not developing an application, but then you can just whatever you have, right? That's fine. And then you go something like when I say whatever. So here I say I want to say word. Yeah. I say word, so I say like something like and you do some kind of validation. So here is where you would execute something. I have nothing to execute because it's just a silly test. So I'm going to do something a word. Then well, I'm going to do absolutely nothing, right? That's boring. And then you hear, oh, actually, I could do something like scenario context. Scenario context. Actually, not this one. Scenario context. Dot. Add. And the key is what? A word. And the value is also excellent. I prefer to do the name of word because I really, really hate magic strings. Very nice. Name of word. What did I do wrong? I did that wrong. Excellent. So like here, it just allows you just to put some properties in a bag, so different steps can do something about it. And then when you hear word two. Then I can do something like
just test, but now you can do some cool stuff, such as this, that, and beam. That I can debug quite well. Oh, I can do something even better than that. I can go here, I can put some breakpoints there if I wanted to. And I want to, because that's what I want. Let's see about that. So again, here you can test your view model, you can test your web application, you can test your services on Azure, you can do whatever you want. We do that as well for like testing or actual services to some extent. That is far too big. Let's remove that a bit. Okay. Oh, breakpoint, fantastic, that works. So given I have a mouth, let's see to that. So path, string mouth equal mouth, mouth should not be null. Excellent. We're doing good. Then when I say something, say so something, which is something, excellent. Now your context, add something, very good. Then you hear something, very good. So let's get back that, let's have a look. Yes, that's definitely what I want, and that should equal that, path. And the test is green, very good. But equally, as you say, as you saw before, all those tests, including the one we saw at the start, on the login page, right? If I just debug login with valid credential, debug unit, let me just close all that to show you something a bit more complicated. Close all documents, sure. That is basically like the auto-generated file behind the scene that just loads to have a test to run. Don't need to do that. That is just done by the engine directly, which is nice. there you go. So let's see about that one, right? Shall we? Just for the sake of sake. Bath. And that is testing like a real mobile phone application as well. It's just not not demo anymore. It's real stuff. Login with valid credential. And the cool thing is I'm reusing those same scenarios to run that against Test Cloud. Remember the thing that you use like on App Center or whatever that is running on real devices, the user interface? I'll show you how it's done. I'm not going to show you it's running because I literally didn't have the time to prepare because I didn't know I was going to speak tonight. I'm speaking, that's very late, but I'm very happy. That's good. I look happy around doing this. Given I am an authenticated user, so that is slightly more involved. Doing some stuff there, don't worry about it. Data growing. So I'm getting all on my state. My state is beautiful, and as I look at the state, state's got other things, it's got some application service. My application is running, it's fantastic. If I look at the state itself, we said, is authenticated? No, I'm definitely not authenticated, and I'm running Android somehow. Cool, very good. So it should be false. That is correct, it is false. We're happy. When I navigate to the login page, go away. Alright, so here I'm going to navigate to, oh that is kind of interesting, but I'm literally using the navigation stuff from Xamarin without user interface. Funky. And I am on my login page. So that is kind of interesting what is happening here. It's not very pretty, but the Xamarin hasn't been built on the Xamarin form, hasn't been built in a way to be very user friendly to test the UI. I'm going to hack it a little bit, or I could go over on the comment pull request to fix it, or whatever. That is literally going to tell me build the user interface. That is failing, and I'm saying just like come on, just like forget about it. It's just going to instantiate a bunch of services. We don't want to do that, so because now we are doing that thing. Login view model, login, I cannot type. Login view model. So it's just doing that, it's just getting all the services done here, right? So it should be slightly tedious. What I want to do though is do something along the line as yes, sir. something at this pool here, or you can on Xamarin, like anything else, you can use like validation that is like attributed, and then just hook up into something that is going to have you just do nothing and validate your beautiful stuff. It is also multilingual, is supported, not that we do anything about it, but yeah, nobody wants you multilingual right now. I wanted to demonstrate a couple of stuff there, and login will be the same. Just to make that. And we just press F5 to go a bit faster. Yeah, whatever. Yeah, go away. Did I fail? No, I didn't. So here we go. So when I log in with my mobile number, so here I'm literally just giving this mobile number to my phone model, right? And it doesn't go anywhere because it's annoying. Ah, whatever. It should have, but that's what happens. So that is just like my delegate command that's got a timer and all that. Let's forget about it a bit. I should be able to get. Ah! See, mobile number now is getting about it, but it's just getting it. Because I was getting the problem. Doesn't matter. Anyway. Hello. Cool. Hey, my phone's being distributed. I'm selling it now. I've got a password, which is password. That's great. And then I'm going to do something, which is just like authenticate. And hopefully the result is going to be happy. Yeah, get this thing. Okay. The result is true. Wow, authenticated. So we can just do something. I'm going to put something in the state. And then I'm going to do something with the cache because it's fun. And then I'm going to ultimately navigate there. Yeah, I'm going to navigate to this page. So then we can just go crazy. I can go to the T home page view model just to prove that it's really going there on page view model. And I'm going to go to constructor. And if I click that, it's going to construct it. Yeah, excellent. So it's really navigating for real. It's just like not made up. So, and then I'm authenticated and it's going to be very happy. Paf, paf. My status reset to true, and ta-da, green. Anyway, that's cool. So the point is, you all the tests you see here that have been built that are real, there was no code at the start. I literally started with writing that thing, and that thing had nothing to back it up. And then you say, okay, the way it just goes is just like, it's like, okay, I've got nothing here. Maybe I need something in my application that will need to have to persist the fact that I'm authenticated or not. So just do that. So let's create a test service. But at present it was nothing, so just everything is red, right? And you just make it up as you go. So for instance, if I want to have, if I put my mobile number, a password, and a company name, let's say, right? Then go like, okay, here, I want a company, change request. Now we need a company name when we log in, and we want to do something or company name, whatever. Oh, I don't have a company name now. Actually, let's make it just like even realer, because why not? And password, and company, Microsoft, of course, Microsoft, best company in the world. And company, Microsoft. So now, oh no, that's broken, it isn't bound to anything because now I've got nothing that is true. It does. Okay. But that's for reason. And company. Now, the reason why it's just like the regex, it's a regex, right? So it's just equally valid. But if I do and company something like that, we can make it automatically generated, but I'm a bit lazy. String company. But the company excellent and company name called company. Oh, but I don't have a company name on my view model. That's all right, I've got ReSharper. ReSharper tells me that if I click that, I've got a company property. Excellent. Company name. Fantastic. And there you go. Now you can do, could just like add to the execute method that now the company name should be related as well. But now, if I run a test, again, that is going to be there. You follow my drift, right? That you should just start with your test that generates the scaffolding, and then you just make up what you need as you go. you don't go, let's create everything I need first and then I test it. No, because usually that ends up with what we saw originally. Remember the diagram that says that is very good there, that is just like what we need to build, and that is not what we need to build and making it well. Well, the problem is if you start building your stuff without knowing or following what you're going to build, you're going to end up in the useless crap situation, which you don't want to have.
What did it do? Is it running? It did something good? Well, it's great, whatever.
Very good. Cool. I think kind of summarize it a little. I hope it was comprehensive and you understand what to do with it. It is actually relatively simple. But if you want some application that actually work, and not only application, but also just have a language that everybody understands, because we're not talking about, oh, can you build a thingy that does some thingies? No. It's not that. We want to make sure that navigating to the About Us page from login page, when I am an authenticated user and click on the About Us button, then I navigate to this page. I just want to make sure that this is happening. And then if I just do that from the home page, I want to do whatever, another bunch of things. That is not a very good example, but for the password, we'll be probably a good one. Enter a valid address with an email. Yes, so you can do like something with ODP, for instance. So when I reset my password with email, then I may redirect it to the forgot password ODP page. By the way, that here is like a variable. So you define something called a scenario outline, and then you can just define some variables, and you can that is a table, which you can add some some data, and each line will just run the scenario. So for instance, if I do something like that and like that, that's not Ellen, that's Bobo and this guy, that is going to be like another test, and that is going to run twice with different data. There he goes. Any questions at all?
Question, yes.
Oh, two questions. He was first. Go on.
So I'm just trying to understand what this fits in. So would this be a replacement for something like Jasmine?
That is just the same thing, but actually you can
like an alternate to it?
No, actually you can use Jasmine would be just under a suggestion.
You can
actually use that to run with Jasmine, but Jasmine is more like the runner, right?
Sorry, I'm making a mistake with
Protractor.
Yes, exactly.
Jasmine is the actual web testing tool for testing the web UI.
Yeah, yes. So that would be you'll be using like Cucumber.js with Protractor in this case.
Okay. So it would be a replacement for Jasmine.
I believe so.
So it is for end-to-end, when you say acceptance testing, it is end-to-end testing.
Well, acceptance test, you mean that you just look at, you put it from the user point of view, from the outside in. You don't care of what is inside the application. You want to make sure that when you interact with the user interface, that is everything. It's just like the user interface stuff. Or if you've got like only interface to be actually precise. But for instance, we're using Cucumber as well, test some services that doesn't have any user interface. Mm-hmm. I want to say that provided that I am a service, when I send that to this mail client, then I have a receipt or you could use this kind of stuff as well, just like impersonation. Does that make sense? But this is, it could be integration test to some extent, but it is acceptance test by default, but you can literally use it on anything because the ID is just some language you can read that everybody understands, that's got a flow, augment as you go. So it's very, very not rare at all that we've got some scenarios we add steps to, because we've got a new feature. Instead of writing the whole test, it just would add us.
So technically, you could write a unit test with this?
That, you can do that, but basically you can. But the problem with a unit test is you've got to think about what the hell you're testing. Here, that's simple, because you just, your user acceptance test, or whatever you're trying to achieve, just provide the scaffolding already.
The reason why I mentioned that is because a lot of times when we write unit tests, just the unit testing, one of the biggest problems we have, at least maybe other people have it as well, is that I might have written the unit test and I know exactly what I'm testing. But when I hand it over to another person, then for them to figure out what the test is supposed to do is can be a challenge. If I have a spec like that, which is easily readable,
yes,
then when I hand it over to another person, it makes them easier.
It makes it very, very, very easy, and it's really easy to extend. And it makes also perfect sense of business and whatever one is. You just say, well, just like having the features just done by whoever actually wants it, or work with the person to define this feature, then after him goes to development, and that is a test for QA as well.
Right.
I mean, just like if you wanted to run that manually, we could do that too, right?
Yeah.
But you can automate
it. You can just use it as a spec for a manual test.
Exactly, and again, the same specification I can run as a background unique console run a test very, very fast, but I can run that on an actual user interface that you would use Protector.
Right.
You bound it, you bound it differently. So what we saw is just running literally up to the view model, but if I wanted to do some UI tests, then I use like Test Cloud, and that looks like, just like an example, right? Page, same, but the same thing, right, pretty much, but here, when I go to step definition, it's going to take its time, whatever, but the step definition is more like that here. But the same test, but it just is implemented differently. Here, yeah, I'm just telling literally the user interface, can you enter the email in the actual UI and the password and just tap the button that is marked as login button. And then I want to validate some stuff that whatever. But that is just working exactly the same way. So you can use the same test and run it just like behind the scene or just like literally directly on the user interface. Why not? Other question? You had a question.
As you just call similar to that. If you've inherited a project.
If you
inherited a project.
Yes.
No unit.
Happy birthday to you.
But then you've got no unit test.
You've got no unit test there.
There's no unit test there. So can you use this? Just create a test
project. You can.
And then use this to create almost the unit test.
You could do that. And if you got some shitty code that you inherited, you could actually probably just like get rid of a bit of technical debt in the process of it.
Yeah, that's
because that forces you to do stuff properly.
Yeah.
You actually cannot produce some technical code by doing that. Because really, and no side effects. Like, and I'm going just to do that for the future. No, no future. Okay. The future is now. Anything for the future is called technical debt, and this is a thing that I'm going to delete later on. With a green. But totally, and you can just make an application that could potentially be ailing and doesn't have the rework period, but just not less necessarily long, into something that is good without starting from scratch by doing that potentially. Quite the application is not too terrible. If it is just like a pile of crap like fitting on the bottom left corner of the graph, then there's nothing can do about it. It's just matter of delete.
But I actually do something useful, then. Trying to change it so
that with that, the thing is just like all your features are here. So technically, all you have here is a universe of everything that your app does, right? That you just put, we manage that in Jira and in Confluence or any other kind of file repository where you have literally everything that your application does is specified in tests. And then you just like increment it as you go, which is very nice. Yes, Ken. It's very hard to build some terrible software with that because that is going to function, it's going to do what you want. And literally as a result, we barely have much bugs returning from what we built. It's just like, if we don't have a full UI stuff that is going to be done to the operating system specific stuff or just due to crap like Samsung, or not crap like Samsung, but just like some phone that are going to do BFs differently.
as we cannot also test everything with Test Cloud because it would cost us a fortune. But we and also you still have to do a fair bit of exploratory testing. That's some cases that we just simply cannot think about. This is what is going to return. But the actual functionality, we never have a single issue with that because it's all tested. And if you go like back, forward, kill the application, restart, forward, well, we might have a bit of a problem for that, but but that's just a very, very kind of minimal. The code quality is like, clients are pretty happy about it, although a client is never really totally happy because I found someone just to think to be a little bit cringy. More questions? Excellent. Then I'm just going to close this computer. Up. Done. And I'm going to kill this thing by clicking on that thing. And the meeting, yes. And meeting. And if it will turn the system off, yes. 26 seconds. 26 seconds, the system will auto-destruct. My next talk will be just prepared. And it would be about like a lot of like all the new stuff in Xamarin, and that's on this week I think or something like that. I requested to have some not very good food. I still believe that developers should eat pizza, so that is going to be pizza and not the very good ones as well. Just average one, not too good, just like average. It's good. Cool. Oh yeah. Oh, applause. Yeah. Whoa! Great job, Ben. But yes, honestly, if you go this way, you never turn back. The learning curve, the stuff is actually very, very simple, but there is a bit of a learning curve because it's so simple, there's a learning curve. But trust me, that is solving a lot of problems. And if you think, oh, it's taking some time, there's some bother, no, it doesn't. It actually doesn't once you're in it. It saves time by not having to think what you need to build, and by just not having some crap bugs and issues that are all things that you were not supposed to even really, really build, returning your way. So everybody is really, really, really happy. So just go for it. And what's with Blazor too, by the way? Because Blazor, which is really, really good, is the rendering engine is actually abstracted, so you can render to the HTML DOM, whatever, or render to the test engine, which is beautiful. That's a cool stuff. So Blazor, that's first, absolutely. I'm using Blazor, but it's not supposed to be used in commercial project. I'm actually starting it. because it's just too good to be true. If you know Blazor, by the way, look also at Mr. Kruger framework called Oui. I probably will do one talk about it, OOUI. Basically, you take Xamarin Forms application and you deploy to the web, just like that. So you can do some PWA with it. Web assembly, of course, because the rest is not fantastic. And you've got access to your service worker, whatever you do, to be able to have some PWA. So you can write once, deploy to iOS, Android, Tizen, Mac, Windows, or web, mobile web, whatever. It is very, very good.